This is a brief overview of the basics of Dataflow, and just a small sampling of my book, Dataflow and Reactive Programming Systems, in which I cover all facets of Dataflow concepts in detail. Please visit our Kickstarter project page or our website to learn more and to pre-order the book at a discount. Let's start with the definition of a node. It receives data, it processes it, and sends it on to the next node. String a few of these together and you get Unix pipes, filters, the pipeline architecture. Nodes can have any number of inputs. In this case, the same operations performed on all inputs. Nodes can also have any number of outputs, too. Here, the result is duplicated for each output. When a node needs multiple data to perform its job, we can name the port to distinguish it from all others. The name describes how the data will be used. Often, implementations with named ports will use rectangular nodes that look very much like integrated circuits in the schematics. Links, also called wires, connections, or edges, are the only way to pass data from node to node. In some situations, we need links to act like buffers, to hold more than one data packet at a time. The link capacity is the maximum number of data packets a link can hold. Often, implementations have a capacity of either one or a few, but theoretically, the link could have an unbounded capacity. It's useful when you have a mismatch in speed between two nodes. The data passing between nodes can be primitive types like integers or booleans, or they can be compound types like objects or structures. Implementation choices can affect this. Data packets may have their own structure and act like a container for the real data. In this case, the data packets themselves may be composed with other data packets to create trees or lists. The data packet would then carry some additional information about how the data should be structured. The choice of data packet representation determines if joins and splits of links are allowed. Some questions to ask yourself about joins. Do you combine the data packets from both links? Do you sequence the data? And what if two packets arrive at the same time? Or we could just disallow them. Splits also cause problems with the reference types. Do you make a copy of the data? Should the copy be deep or shallow? And what about garbage collection? Or we could just punt and disallow them also. The easy way is to defer responsibility to the nodes because they already understand the data format. In designing a Dataflow system, you have to decide if you want to use a push or pull model. In the push model, the constant node is evaluated first, putting its data, 42, on the output link. The increment node then receives the value on its input, adds 1 to it, and puts a result on this output link, where it can be used by the next node. In the pull model, the final output is first requested. This causes the increment node to request the data it needs from the constant node. Since the constant node doesn't need any inputs before it can be evaluated, it simply places the value 42 on its output. The increment node now has all the data it needs to execute, so it puts the new value, 43, on its output, and we're done. The push model can be said to have eager evaluation, while the pull model has lazy evaluation. Push is reactive to changing data, while pull can be said to be inactive to changing data. Push is similar to events, while pull is similar to subroutine call semantics. Now the question, when should the node be evaluated? In the push model, there are two possibilities. One, it should be evaluated only when all the inputs are available, or two, it should be evaluated when at least one input is available. In the pull model, there's only one choice. A node should be evaluated when any one of its outputs are requested. For nodes that have multiple outputs, it's up to the designer to determine if they want to cache the currently unneeded output or not. Nodes can be executed either synchronously or asynchronously. In this example, we have two nodes with different real-world execution times. B is a fast process, while A is slow. With synchronous execution, both A and B have data on their inputs, so they both can execute. B gets done first, but A is still working. This brings us to the first point. Synchronous execution means all the nodes execute at the same time, and their execution always takes exactly one instant. So in this case, even though B is done, we have to wait for A to complete before we can move on. An instant has no bearing on real-world time. It is simply a name we give to the time required to execute all the nodes that can execute. Now that A is also done, we can transfer both the outputs to C. Synchronous systems are only as fast as its slowest node. With asynchronous execution, nodes execute as soon as possible, and their outputs are never delayed due to other slow-running nodes. Again, both A and B have data, so they can execute. Yet this time, B can push its data to C and start working on the next data packet, while A is still working on its first. If C can do its work without the value from A, then I'll process the output value from B and be done. Unlike synchronous systems, asynchronous systems are able to run at full speed.